This video contains images that may be disturbing to some viewers. Viewer discretion is advised. No society, regardless of how technologically or culturally advanced, will last forever. The ancient Roman Empire, with all of its wealth and huge territories, eventually broke down and dissolved. And even today, you can look to the news channels and independent bloggers that are recording the collapse of civilizations and societies all around the world, as major political and social shifts are happening all over the globe. And what makes Escape from Tarkov so fascinating is how we can immerse ourselves in a modern society that has completely broken down. It's fascinating in a macabre kind of way to see supermarkets that have been completely ransacked of all their goods, a gas station on fire, and military and emergency vehicles that have been abandoned. Chances are that most people viewing this video right now have lived their entire lives never seeing shop windows broken open by looters, or their local police flee as the neighborhoods around them erupt in violence. And hopefully, they never will. But today I want to analyze what exactly pushed some of the citizens of Tarkov to this breaking point. How did conditions get so bad that a factory worker or accountant would take up a rifle and be willing to kill another man just for his next meal? Let's explore how the citizens of Tarkov became scavs. First, let's look at how society and order broke down in Tarkov in the first place. It's unknown exactly when Tarkov City was first established, but I think it's safe to assume that due to the Norvinsk Special Economic Zone, the city of Tarkov is all relatively new development. One hint is of course the ongoing construction that we can see on almost every map. But people definitely lived within Tarkov before the massive urbanization and modernization of the area, as we can see from places such as Shoreline, where small truck stop towns and rural homesteads are evidence of how life used to be before favorable business incentives brought a huge influx of people into the region. As soon as USEC started exchanging fire with the Russian FSB and eventually even the Russian armed forces, at some point the UN got involved and the entire situation nearly turned into a global incident after Russian troops were tricked into engaging UN forces by an unknown and mysterious third party. Meanwhile, the Russian government was made aware of the fact that during all of these skirmishes, high-ranking terror group personnel were fleeing the Tarkov area and taking as much sensitive information and equipment with them as possible. The highest-ranking individuals successfully escaped via a cargo ship named the Ocean Slogger, with an unknown amount of sensitive intelligence. To prevent any more evidence from leaving the area, the decision to completely blockade the entire Tarkov area was made by the Russian Federation, and a complete evacuation order was given for all Russian citizens from the Tarkov region. How long this evacuation lasted, and how evacuees were screened to prevent terror group personnel from blending in with the refugees is unknown. But there are a few clues that make me believe that the evacuation effort took quite some time, and that before the evacuation could be completed, hostilities were becoming quite intense between USEC and Bear, as well as armed citizens also beginning violence against basically anyone and everyone that looked like an opportunity. As we can see on maps such as Customs and Shoreline, buses and personal vehicles were headed out of Tarkov, escorted by the Russian military, but some had been ambushed and abandoned. So this is the basic cause for societal collapse: armed conflict that led to a rapid general evacuation order of a large metropolitan area, and the evacuation itself only being partially successful. So what would make the citizens of the area turn violent? Unfortunately, we have all too many examples of how average people can become violent all around us in the world today. From Africa, the Middle East, and beyond, military invasions, civil war, religious and ideological fanaticism, natural disasters, and political crises happen in real life on a daily basis, displacing families and causing shortages of basic survival needs such as food, water, and shelter. Even in the first world developed countries, it only takes a few days to a few weeks of interrupted electricity, running water, and food shortage to turn neighbors into looters. Put yourself in the shoes of someone who was trapped within Tarkov and missed the opportunity to evacuate. For days or weeks, with the city sealed off, various everyday necessities would begin to become less plentiful and then become completely unavailable. Shops and stores that were still operating would no longer be getting new shipments, so buying groceries would become more and more difficult until store shelves were completely barren. F- Fuel trucks would no longer replenish gas stations, and everyone still in the city would be rushing to fill every spare fuel can they could get their hands on, until gasoline was no longer able to be purchased, also making the evacuation effort even more difficult. Eventually, the power would have most likely been shut off in large service areas, causing widespread panic and a near complete shutdown of many municipal services. Hospitals would be understaffed and overcrowded. As each modern-day service and luxury became less plentiful or ceased to function completely, panic would build. And another curious observation is the lack of wildlife in Tarkov, other than birds. In many post-apocalyptic or zombie movies and TV shows, the world seems empty, with very few survivors, and those that have survived can hunt and live off the land. In reality, even in the deadliest disasters, there are usually large populations of survivors, and local wildlife was most likely hunted to extinction in a very short amount of time, from livestock to deer to finally small animals like squirrels and even rodents. Anyone with a firearm and an empty belly would make quick work of these food sources. And as families started to go hungry, and fathers and sons watched their children, wives, or loved ones become ill, or even die from lack of proper nutrition or medicine, you have a choice. Sit there and slowly watch everyone you love die, before eventually dying yourself, or grab the shotgun in your closet and go take what you need from someone who has it. It's easy to say that you'd be noble and either avoid or aid others in a time of crisis, when your belly is full and the lights are on and the water is running. But when you haven't eaten in days, and more houses on your block are being broken into each night, with no rescue on the way, I bet you'd act differently. But I highly doubt that every scav within Tarkov picked up a rifle or a shotgun and descended into primitive madness immediately. For many, it was a slow and reluctant process. Many survivors likely tried to hide out for as long as they could, scavenging whatever scraps they could find, avoiding the gangs for as long as possible. But eventually, emaciated and exhausted, the horrible choice would eventually have to be made. Either join the gangs or die. In Tarkov, when the evacuation order was given, those who got trapped within the region can be separated into a few groups: criminals, the ignorant or defiant, the unlucky, and the disadvantaged. Let's break down each group. Criminals are the nastiest of the bunch and were probably the first to engage in violence. These would be the types of people who lived their entire lives bending or breaking the law, and were no strangers to becoming predators of the weak. The crisis within Tarkov would just look like an opportunity to them, an opportunity to grow their influence of their gang or increase their personal wealth. With no police around to enforce the laws, they'd finally be able to take what they wanted, when they wanted, and these most likely became the leaders of the various scav gangs. They also most likely recruited able-bodied survivors into their ranks, either willingly or by force, and were probably the first to set up relations with powerful figures in the region, such as dealers or anyone with connections to the outside. Rishala is a good example of this type of person. The ignorant or defiant are those who either refuse to believe that the crisis evolving within Tarkov was really that bad, or simply refuse to leave the place they called home. Evidence of this can be found everywhere in all disasters around the world, and throughout history. During Hurricane Katrina, and even within the Chernobyl exclusion zone, there are always those who absolutely refuse to leave, or downplay just how dangerous it is to stay. Some of these would eventually become scavs, but others would have been preyed on by the scavs. And the unlucky. Again, examples of these types of people are included in the casualty reports of every disaster throughout human history. They didn't hear the news. They left a little too late. They decided to go back for something or someone they forgot, or something held them up long enough for them to miss the evacuation bus. A high percentage of these types of people most likely ended up becoming victims of the scav gangs, but some may have been unwillingly assimilated into scav gangs if given the opportunity, if it meant survival. And lastly, the disadvantaged, the most heartbreaking group of all. These would have been the children separated from their parents, elderly in assisted care facilities, or the disabled. They never evacuated when the order was given because they couldn't move fast enough, or nobody came to get them. I'll never forget some of the images of the assisted care facilities in Texas after the intense flooding from Hurricane Harvey. In nearly every disaster, there are those who are left behind that cannot evacuate themselves. Thankfully, we don't have much evidence of this in Tarkov, but as we've seen from some Streets of Tarkov teasers, the developers will touch on it. None of these people ever became scavs, as when humans revert to medieval Dark Ages survival rules, there just isn't room for anyone who can't provide benefit to the group or defend themselves. And lastly, difficulty and violence alone does not always drive people to become violent. As seen in wars and disasters around the world, even when faced with extreme conditions, communities can come together peacefully to persevere. But in Tarkov, the sense of community was disrupted by the Terror Group Corporation and the Norvinsk Special Economic Zone. For the same reasons that drove mega corporations around the world to set up their corporate headquarters and factories within the Norvinsk Zone is exactly what left a large portion of the populace feeling alienated and disadvantaged. With near zero regulations and low corporate taxes, there was likely very little protections put in place for low-wage earners within Tarkov. To further increase profits, workplace safety regulations were most likely removed, and while offers of work were abundant within Tarkov, wages were most likely very low. As people flocked to the region with a promise of an economic paradise, that paradise was most likely in favor of the corporate elite, and not for the factory floor worker. In Tarkov, we see new factories being built, such as on customs, and high-end housing under construction, like the cottages on Shoreline. But factory workers lived in the cramped and communal housing of the dorms area, as it was likely all they could afford. The factory itself probably saw its fair share of workplace accidents, while its employees were paid very little. It's no surprise that when society began to deteriorate, that many would turn to violence, as even before the city was ever sealed off, many citizens had already felt trapped in Tarkov. And it's also no surprise that two scab bosses and two dealers were once factory workers, with Mechanic being very vocal about his disdain for modern society and corporate culture. From this, the fact that Tarkov has such a high population of criminal gangs and violent loners is not only plausible, but likely. And with the scav karma system brings a new level of immersion, as these left behind and neglected citizens most likely share at least some small sense of camaraderie, even though there are certainly those among them willing to cut the throat of a scav brother for a fresh bottle of water, or some spare ammunition. In the future, it'll be interesting to see how scavs change in future patches, as well as our interactions with them as stranded PMCs. Perhaps there may be future quests where you need to help scavs evacuate from Tarkov, and there could even be tasks where you need to rescue or evacuate unarmed civilians that somehow avoided becoming part of the scav gangs, including hostage rescue. From a story standpoint, I'd like to think that someday these scavs will eventually escape or seek redemption and rehabilitation, but I have a new theory with supporting evidence that the Tarkov exclusion zone may grow in the future. But that video will have to wait for another day. Until then, I'm Jeff with EUL Gaming. Good luck out there.